Now, despite what God may be doing and new paths He's taking us on, several things never change. And one of those things that never changes, we are hungry to see people come to Jesus Christ. I don't care how new things get. I don't care what God does. It all comes back to glorifying God and seeing sinners saved. I want to be like old John Wesley. Wesley had this passion to see people come to Jesus Christ. And in fact, there was a man that was really, Wesley was his hero back in the day. And he always wanted to hear John Wesley preach. And so one day he found out he was going to be in a city kind of far away. And so he traveled for several days to go hear John Wesley preach. And when he got there, Wesley preached from John chapter 3, "You must be born again." It was a great sermon. And this guy was thrilled. It'd be like somebody always wanting to hear Billy Graham, finally hearing Billy Graham preach. So he heard him, came back. Several months later, he found out Wesley was going to be in his hometown. And so he said, I'm going to go hear Wesley preach again. And so he got to hear Wesley a second time. When Wesley got up to preach, he preached from John 3 again. "You must be born again." And afterward, this man went up to Wesley and said, "Sir, I've always wanted to meet you. You've been a hero of mine. I heard you a couple months ago, and you preached on John 3. You must be born again. I've heard you preach today. You preached the same thing. You must be born again." He said, "Let me ask you, why is it every time I hear you preach, you preaching, you must be born again?" And Wesley responded with a little twinkle in his eye, "Because you must be born again." Beloved, there is no other way to salvation but being born again through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to understand, though, the tools we use to glorify God cannot become our God. Are you with me? The things we use to glorify God, the things we use to advance the gospel, cannot become our God. I want you to think about that and remember that as we go into the Word today. Turn, if you would, to Numbers 21. We'll go a different direction next week and all this kind of, but I just, as we're starting this new season and this new era in First Assembly, I think the Lord would have me give you a word of caution today. Numbers 21, and I want you to look, if you would, at verse 4. Now, you know the story. God's people have been in bondage for 400 years. God's led them out of bondage. They are now in the Sinai desert going toward the promised land. And here's what happened in verse 4. They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses, and they said, "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." All right, so I want you to see this. God listens very carefully to griping and complaining and bellyaching. We think on the totem pole of things God hates, that's like real far down. But I want you to see that as God's people complained against the leadership, against God Himself, here's how God responded, verse 6. "Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, 'We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us.' So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, 'Make a snake and put it on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live.' So Moses made a bronze snake and put it on the pole." Let me say this. Hebrew word for bronze is also the Hebrew word for copper. And it's interesting that at this part of the Sinai Desert today, you can go and find massive copper mines. There's copper all over the place. So Moses probably took bronze, he took copper, he makes this snake. So Moses made a bronze snake, put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, he lived. Now you see, it's a powerful picture. You see this thing. They complain against God. God sends these snakes into their camp, and even today in the Sinai Peninsula, there is a kind of snake called a carpet adder. It's highly toxic, highly venomous. Those snakes come in, they bite you. It's a very painful death. It burns. They inject this poison into you that begins to constrict your lungs. You cannot breathe. It paralyzes your system, and so it's a horrible way to die. And so as they're being bitten and as they're dying, they're saying, "Moses, we're sorry. We should not cry out against God and against you. Help us." You see the story. God says, "Make a bronze, make a copper snake, put it on a pole. If somebody's bitten and they look at the snake, they live." Now, it's a powerful story. But then about 1,400 years later, Jesus takes this same story and he uses the story to illustrate the gospel. I'm amazed at how hard it is sometimes for us to articulate what the gospel really is. And I do the same thing. Have you noticed that sometimes when you're trying to share the gospel, you start going off on these little rabbit trails, and pretty soon you've confused your hearers and yourself? Has it ever happened to you before? I mean, that's happened to me. I was on an airplane a couple years ago, and I tried to give a very clear gospel message, and the guy asked me, well, what do you evangelicals think about abortion? And I found myself kind of talking about abortion. And they said, well, what do you think about gay marriage? And after about 10 minutes, I realized I'm not talking anything about the gospel. I'm talking around the whole thing. Jesus in John chapter 3 says, this story that you've just read is a powerful picture of what the gospel is. So I want you to hold your place there and turn to John chapter 3. Because Nicodemus, who's a brilliant religious leader, comes to Jesus and he basically wants to know, what is this gospel? What is this good news? What's this message? And Jesus says in John chapter 3, verse 14, he says, Nicodemus, I'm going to reach back into Israel's history. I'm going to go back to this story I just told you about Moses lifting up a bronze serpent, and when anybody was bitten and they look at the serpent, they're healed. I want to use that to explain what the gospel is. And he says there in verse 14, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. What he's saying is, all right, Nicodemus, in the Old Testament, when people got bit by this snake, God says to Moses, Moses, make an image of the thing that is killing these people, put it on a pole, and if they look at it, they'll be healed. And what Jesus is saying is, the human race has been bitten by the one thing that will kill every human being physically and spiritually. You know what it is? It's sin. There's only one terminal illness. It's not cancer, it's not AIDS, it's not Alzheimer's. There's only one terminal illness, and that illness is sin. Every one of us has sinned against God. Every one of us has been bitten by sin. Every one of us is on our way to eternal death because of sin. And what Jesus says is, just like in the Old Testament, when God says to Moses, make an image of the thing that is killing the people, put it on a pole, and if they look at it, they'll live. What God is about to do through me, he is about to make me sin. Not going out and sinning, but 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. Jesus never did sin. But as Jesus hung on the cross, spiritually, God did something. God laid all of our sin on Jesus. And again, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he became sin for us. The one thing that bit us and would kill us and send us to hell, Jesus became. And when Jesus was put on that pole, when he was put on the cross, he was lifted up. And Jesus says, in the same way, every one of you who are sinners, who are headed to hell, if you will just look at me and believe in me, you'll be healed. Pray. Is that not, church, is powerful. That's the gospel. The gospel is not work hard and try to earn your salvation. The gospel is Jesus became sin for us. He was lifted up on the cross. And if you will just look to Jesus, if you'll just believe in Jesus. It's interesting, in the Old Testament, God says to Moses, tell the people to what? Look at the snake. In John chapter 3, verse 14, Jesus, or verse 15, Jesus says, those who believe. What Jesus is trying to say is, looking in the Old Testament, believing in the New Testament, it's the same thing. You look to Jesus and you're saved. Now listen to me. If somebody had said, Moses, I've been bitten by the snake, I'm dying here. And if Moses would have said, just look at the snake and you'll live. And they said, well, you know, I don't think I just have to look at the snake. Moses, I believe I can look at lots of things. Lots of things will bring me healing. I believe I can look at that tree and I'll be healed. I believe I can look at that rock and I'll be healed. I believe I can look at that mountain and I'll be healed. That person would have died. There was only one thing that would bring them healing, and that's looking at the snake. Some of you are saying, I can look to Buddha and be saved. I can look to Muhammad and be saved. I can look to this religion and be saved. No, you only look to Jesus and be saved. Now, if somebody said to Moses, Moses, it doesn't make any sense to me scientifically. Scientifically, you explain to me how me, with poison going through my body, can look at this snake and be healed, and while that person's trying to figure it out scientifically, he would have died. So you're trying to figure out this whole Jesus God thing scientifically. You'll never figure it out. It's beyond you. His ways are not your ways. His thoughts are not your thoughts. You don't figure it out. You just look to Jesus. If one of them had said to Moses, "Moses, I have been bitten and I'm dying. But Moses, I think I have a little bit of time left. And what I'm going to do is wait to the end of my life when I'm just gasping for breath. Let me do what I want to do. And at the end of my life, then I'll look at the snake and I'll be healed." That person would have died. And I got people here today saying, "I'll trust in Jesus one day. I'll look to Jesus one day. But I want to live my life and do what I want to do. And you will die in your sin." If somebody had said to Moses, "Moses, I've been bitten by the snake." And Moses said, "Well, look, just look at the copper snake and you'll live." And they said, "Well, that's too simple. I got to do something. I got to go to a doctor. I got to find some medicine. I got to do something to help God out." If they had done that, they would have died. And some of you are saying, "This is too easy. Just look to Jesus and I'll be saved." No, I got to say some Hail Marys and I got to burn some incense and I got to give some money and buy some Girl Scout cookies and recycle. I got to do all this good stuff. No. It's all about Jesus. You look to Jesus and you'll be saved. What Jesus is saying is the human race has been bitten by the one thing that will kill every human being physically and spiritually. You know what it is? It's sin. There's only one terminal illness. It's not cancer, it's not AIDS, it's not Alzheimer's. There's only one terminal illness, and that illness is sin. Every one of us has sinned against God. Every one of us has been bitten by sin. Every one of us is on our way to eternal death because of sin. And what Jesus says is, just like in the Old Testament, when God says to Moses, "Make an image of the thing that is killing the people, put it on a pole, and if they look at it, they'll live." What God is about to do through me, He is about to make me sin. Not going out and sinning, but 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, "He made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us." And Jesus says, in the same way, every one of you who are sinners, who are headed to hell, if you will just look at me and believe in me, you'll be healed.